So we start off with Japanese or Chinese eggplants. You want them kind of long and nice and beautifully firm like this. Some high quality butter, you know, whatever you can get that's delicious and beautiful. We'll be eventually browning this to kind of bring up some of that nuttiness. Three eggs, let's see, a tablespoon of Japanese vinegar, some rice wine vinegar, some kosher salt to taste, and some sake for our miso sauce. So this is a white miso that we're using. It's an organic white miso. We'll start with this butter in a pan that's on low heat. We want to kind of, when you're browning butter, what you really want to do is take it down kind of low and slow here. And you're kind of bringing up the temperature of this butter very slowly. What I'm looking for as it's kind of turning from what you're seeing right now into the finished product is something that becomes to be a little bit nuttier and complex. Once you get to this point, you'll see a little bit of a separation from the foam and the butter itself. And if you could smell this, you could smell a lot of that nutty profile. You'll see a lot of that, the solids kind of making their way down to the bottom of the pan here. Typically at the restaurant, we would filter this, but for this reason, you know, I want to be able to kind of taste that in the final product. And we've got our white miso here ready to go. It's about a cup and a half. We're going to go just directly into the pot here. You're not really supposed to boil miso. You want to bring it up to a simmer. This is such a straightforward sauce. It's kind of the mother's sauce. It's like the secret base sauce in a lot of Japanese ingredients or Japanese restaurants. So the ratio here with the sake and the miso is a little bit, they're almost equal parts. So all of this into one pot. We're going to scoop out our mustard here and pour in. So all of your ingredients are in one pot here. You're going directly onto the stove. You kind of let these ingredients kind of cook down and simmer slowly. And as it comes up to almost a low simmer, you're going to keep it no higher than that point and just let it come down until it kind of tightens right back up. So this is the finished version of the sauce. You notice that it gets a little bit darker. I've transferred it into a smaller pot. It almost has like a kind of caramel sauce consistency. It looks like a caramel. A lot of people put miso in caramel for that reason. So for the eggplant, when we're cooking it, what we want to do is you want to create some perforation. You can do that by kind of getting your eggplant flat on your cutting board like this and poking holes just throughout. You want to do this so it helps kind of release the air and the pressure that gets built up inside as you're charring it. I'll just do these to a few of these. As you notice, I'm kind of just like sticking the very tip of my knife here down into the eggplant. No pattern in particular, just a few holes to kind of allow some of that heat to escape so it doesn't burst and kind of make a mess all over the place. Putting this on the stove, you know, you can do this in any kind of open fire. A gas stove is great. Charcoal is amazing. But what we do at the restaurant really is get your fire going here and get your eggplant directly on the heat. And what you want to do is, as you'll notice here, especially in this particular, we have one of our older burners here. We have a higher flame on this end and some of the lower flames. You kind of want to start at the higher flame, especially at the thickest part of the eggplant. And what we do is we treat this like a piece of meat. When we're cooking meat at the restaurant, you want even heat distribution throughout. So, you know, in my head, I'll count to, you know, maybe 30 seconds, depending on how high the heat is. Sometimes we'll set a timer for about 1 minute or 2 minutes and just give a rotation to the eggplant. So the eggplant's pretty fully charred throughout now. We want to let the residual heat do its job, and we're going to remove this. We're going to kill our heat, remove this from the stove here very carefully. And what I like to do, honestly, is just cover it with some plastic to, we could use foil as well, to make sure that the steam from the eggplant and the heat kind of permeate and cook through. So just kind of cover this up here. And then this should kind of hang out for a second. Cool, so we're gonna take this eggplant. It's fully kind of cooked and soft here throughout. I'm gonna place it into a tray like this. And what I wanna do is, I have my gloves on, prepare a bowl of water. This bowl of water is amazing for this task because what happens naturally is you're going to be using a paring knife to kind of scrape off the skin that you've kind of diligently burned around the outside of this eggplant. As soon as that skin touches the water, it helps you kind of allow these things to collapse directly in and keeps your knife and this whole task basically very clean. But you just want to remove this here carefully, trying to keep that eggplant as intact as possible. So you want to keep the integrity of the shape of the eggplant as much as possible as well. So now we have our clean eggplant. A lot of the char is off. You can always use the back of your knife to kind of go through here and just scrape off any residual bits. That's really just to reduce the amount of bitterness in this final, like once you kind of plated up your dish here. So because we've used our gloves, we've been able to work pretty clean here. This goes onto our cutting board. And what I do to prepare this really is clean my knife up here a bit. I want to line up my eggplant and flatten it so it's easy to portion. And then we're just going to remove the top. That's something that my mom doesn't do. Traditionally in Filipino cooking, you always keep the top of the eggplant on. That just allows you to have some control in the pan to flip them over. So, and kind of like a surgeon here, we're going to split the side of this open, spread it out to kind of create a larger surface area here. And now we're going to prepare our eggs and have our eggs ready to go here for the omelet aspect of this dish. We start off with three eggs. You want to crack them and go directly into your bowl. You know, this is, remembering this is a breakfast dish at my family's house. This is such a smell that I will always remember, is kind of, and a sound I can hear is my mom kind of beating these eggs a little bit. And you start by kind of punching down the yolks before you kind of start kind of agitating them. Take a little bit of kosher salt here. This goes directly into our egg mixture. Not an overly smooth product that we're looking for necessarily here, but tap out our remaining yolk here. Finish with our salt for right now. Then we go back to our eggplant. This eggplant goes into your tray. Just want to get this kind of lightly seasoned egg batter into this tray as well. Just enough to kind of cover the surface of the tray there. We've got our eggplant here ready to go in our pan. We want to get our pan nice and hot here. This brown butter goes right back into the pan. I want to swirl that a little bit to distribute it. We're at a medium high here. We don't want to be too hot. What we're going to do is just let this egg yolk and gravity play a little bit of a part here. So the sound that you're hearing and that kind of instant kind of swelling and puffing. It's a lot of Asian cuisine, especially, you know, when you're in Thailand, when you're in Singapore, when you're in the Philippines, certainly, you see a lot of like crispy, crunchy, brown, delicious eggs. Sometimes, you know, as you can see at the start of this, there was a generous amount of fat in the pan. We want a lot of that fat. We want a lot of this heat as well. So I just like to swirl this a little bit, keep it moving. I'll remove it from my heat a little bit so I don't have a lot of heat exposure while I'm checking it. You can kind of see at the edges here some of the browning starting to occur. You see it's kind of swelled up into sort of a raft here, but that's from all the fat. I want to cook the center a little bit more so there's less movement inside. You can do one of two things. You can flip this if you're comfortable doing that at home, or you can take a spatula and flip it. What I like to do here so I get less of a splatter is I'll kind of tilt this pan away from myself and then back down towards myself. And we'll encourage some of these eggs to run this way. What we really do now is kind of flip this omelette And you finish it by flipping it over, killing your heat and letting some of that residual heat from the pan kind of come through. So just want to flip it. We finish it with a little bit of kosher salt once it's flipped here. And about after a minute, we're ready to go. And I'm just going to lift this off the pan here. And then what we want to do is just kind of let it sit here and cool down a bit before we decide to cut it. Great, so we just want to trim the sides here just a little bit. Those are my sort of pre-service snacks. It's not really, it's really funny, they do end up on my desk somehow every day. So we want to roll this just like a little bit like a tamago. Great, so now we're just kind of reheating the sauce. We want to bring it up just slightly here. I want to bring it to a state where I feel like we can enjoy the texture and the flavor a little bit. We're just going to just skim the surface. You want to ensure that as you're saucing this, every bite of this omelet is going to get some of this miso sauce. You can really get the brightness from that mustard sauce kind of coming through here. The sweetness from the miso definitely really comes through as well, and really kind of helps to accentuate, you know, what will be a pretty rich and luxurious thing to have.